Welcome to Italics, television for the Italian-American experience. I'm your host, Anthony Tamburri. Italics Women's History Month features Loredana Polezzi. She is the Alfonso D'Amato Chair in Italian-American and Italian Studies at Stony Brook University. She previously held posts in translation studies at Cardiff University and Italian Studies at Warwick University in the UK. Loredana's work concentrates on multiple forms of Italian mobility, its history, its representation, and theorization. Loredana talks with us about Italian diaspora and Italian communities transnationally. Loredana, welcome to Italics. It's wonderful to have you.
It's a pleasure, and thank you for the invitation, Anthony.
You come to us from Great Britain. You hold now at Stony Brook University the Alfonso D'Amato Chair for Italian and Italian-American Studies, dealing obviously with the Italian diaspora as a good part of your charge as a professor. But you also sort of did a little bit of internal migration in Great Britain, Cardiff, then Wales, and so on and so forth. And so here you are now, truly, what can we say, someone who has quote-unquote crossed the ocean.
I keep saying to friends that I feel a bit like a drama queen, which is not normally me, because everybody's saying, oh, goodness, you've managed to arrive in the United States. And it sounds almost as if I swam the Atlantic, which I didn't. But nevertheless, because of what has happened over the last year and what's happened over the last few months, it was not easy to get here. And finally, it feels like, you know, a real relief to be able to be on Long Island, to be able to work from here. I have been working now for a few months in my new position as the D'Amato Chair, but finally I can do it from where I am meant to be. So I'm originally from Tuscany in Italy. That's where I grew up, on the side of a hill town near Cortona. And then from there, a long time ago, I migrated to the UK. So I am myself part of the Italian diaspora in that sense. I've been for a while, but mostly in the UK. First in England, at Warwick University, then at Cardiff in Wales. And now, yes, I'm joining the numbers of those from Italy who are in the US. Though not an Italian-American as such. I did ask my students the other day, my very first lesson, what do you think I am? And they had quite a good time guessing and asking me questions about it.
So here you are, doubly hyphenated, you know, with a double privilege if we look at the hyphen as a privilege.
I will take that accolade any day.
Let me ask you just to describe one or two of your previous activities, because in addition to the intellectual work that you do, your teaching, your service to the profession, et cetera, you and your other colleagues a few years ago had this wonderful international project, for lack of a better word. And we were part of it, and we were delighted to be part of it, both in the sense of having a conference here, a symposium, but also in this wonderful exhibit that you all put together that was technologically advanced, I think, to the max for that time.
The project that you're referring to, it has a mouthful of a name. It's called Transnationalizing Modern Languages. And then it also had a subtitle to that, which referred to the focus on Italian diaspora and Italian migrant communities and so on. The project was and remains a starting point, or not necessarily starting, but a reference point for this movement that we have seen over the past few years, in which the Calandra has been absolutely central, and indeed you were an active partner in the project itself, a movement towards thinking about Italian studies in a transnational fashion. And then beyond that, thinking about modern languages in a transnational fashion. So going beyond this idea, what has been called, and I do think of as methodological nationalism, which was inbuilt into the kind of 19th century, early 20th century structure of modern languages as a discipline or as a set of disciplines, and also into the institutional structures that we then found ourselves working into. And more intellectually, but also pedagogically, I think we feel that is a stricture that is really much very much constraining what we're doing, and we don't think in those ways any longer. So there's been this move to think transnationally, which doesn't mean that we think that nations don't matter any longer, or they don't exist, or that national cultures don't exist, but it's about that dialogue that I always say, you know, it's about that tension between the national dimension and the international dimension. And in the case of Italy, again, I was teaching just last night, and I was talking about the fact that to understand Italian cultures, you always have to think below the scale of the nation. You have to think locally, you have to think about regional, city, you know, all of those senses of local identities. And then you also have to think much bigger. You have to think beyond the nation. A, because for a long time Italy didn't exist as a nation, but also because Italians are literally all over the world. And for me, that's been the fundamental moment in that project, that shift in perspective. And then when I was coming in that project, I had become curious for a whole number of reasons, and I'd started to work already on Italian-American culture because of its iconicity also in terms of that transnational diasporic formation. And so when it then came to this project, I thought I had to carve a piece of the world, if you want, for myself. And I said, I'll be working on Italian-American and also Italian-Australian to an extent. And when I started doing that, for me, the other side of that perspective became, well, we don't want to think about Italian-American studies as some kind of, you know, lost child of or smaller entity attached to Italian culture. What we really need to think about is the dialogue between those tensions and those interchanges. And that's where that project has taken us. For me, I arrived at the project from two sides. One, this idea of diasporic Italian studies, and the other one, I work in translation studies. So for me, everything is always dialogical in that sense. But the two things have fed each other in thinking about translation. Working on such a project has also made me think, we don't want to think of translation just as from A to B and then it stops. Really creative, interesting, productive translation are the phenomena that keep bouncing off, you know, keep going backwards and forwards. It's like a ping pong ball translation in that sense. It keeps going in off in different directions. And then the interesting thing is that that project that started as an Italian studies project got bigger and bigger. And so we then, we've produced volumes. There's one behind me, but I've also got it here, which is Transcultural Italies that's just come out. So we produce volumes which are on Italian diasporic transnational cultures. But we also sort of set in place or set going a whole series of other strands of research and working with other colleagues. So we now have a whole series with Liverpool University Press, which is transnational modern languages. And so we've gone into Francophone and Lusophone. And the next phase is going to look at Asia, is going to look at the Arab world. It's really grown in that sense, and it's made us think about a whole host of methodological questions, not just historical and cultural. And then that took us also in a direction which was incredibly meaningful, but totally unexpected. It took us also to work in Africa with colleagues in Namibia and then in Zambia. And you think, what is a bunch of Italianists doing there? But actually it made sense because we were talking about this transnational circulation. We were talking about multilingualism and...
That was influential for our thinking as well. One of the things we did was eventually, because we found ourselves in the practical sense, we found ourselves able to do so. We invited about 20 to 25 people from different parts of Europe, Italy, and one or two other places, and then a lot of people from the United States. And I think it was January 19, 2019, we had a really good, or 18, we had a really good meeting. That I like to think solidified some connections and things of that sort.
You know, the calendar was fundamental for all of this in so many ways. A, because earlier on, you know, I would never have started really thinking about these things without having been at some of the conferences at the Calandra and met a number of colleagues there. The collaborative nature of research is something that perhaps in the humanities we are now becoming more and more used to in these large projects. But it's an ethos, it's a methodology, and I think the Calandra is fantastic for that as a point of aggregation, but also as a point of, you know, communicating that ethos of working together with community, with other colleagues, and so on.
We were fortunate also because back in 14, before we knew what you guys were doing on the other side of the ocean and north of the continent, we ended up at the Rockefeller Center in Bellagio for a week with some people from Italy and from the United States. And, you know, that was part of solidifying, at least from the point of view of Italian-American / Italian-North American studies, that got us involved a little bit. There have since been people in Italy with whom we've connected, you know, whether it's in Calabria, later in Rome, or for our Italian Diaspora Studies Summer Seminar. These people are, quote unquote, the Americanists in Italy. And of course, that sense of Italian hyphen, whatever, Italian hyphen German, Italian hyphen French, Italian hyphen, you know, Great Britain, et cetera, up until about 20, 25 years ago, very few people were doing that in Italy.
And then there is, of course, that other phenomenal initiative that the Calandra and the Italian Historical Museum in Melbourne and the Museo del Mare in Genoa, the Galata Museum, also started off with this triangulation of conferences across the world. The beauty of this is also that we all bring different perspectives, so different cultural perspective, different academic perspectives, but also different positionings. We can then really think and imagine what we're doing in ways which would be impossible if we were not, connected as much as we are. You know, that image of the academic shut up in a library and then not talking to anybody, I think it's definitely not something I ever particularly loved.
No, we've debunked that. I think we've debunked that in a good way to a certain degree. A number of years ago, this book arrived, and it was the book that you and Jennifer Burns had put together.
That was published by
Iannone. Yeah.
That was 2003, I think, if I remember correctly, the publication of that book. And the conference that it came from, it would have been 2001, 2002. So we literally are talking about work, you know, that is coming to fruition, that has grown and grown. But it is the commitment of 20 years of work. But then years later, we started seeing people like Teresa Fiore and other colleagues mentioning it again and saying, actually, that was a starting point, for instance, of trying to bring together. At the time, what we were trying to do was, we weren't yet thinking diasporically so much, but we were trying to bring together three perspectives: the perspective of Italian studies about Italian immigration, the perspective of studies about Italian immigration towards Italy, and then the internal migration. And these traditionally tend to be studied separately. And we thought, okay, what if we put together the specialists in these three areas and try to see what happens? And then years later, I've seen that book mentioned a number of times as a starting point for that.
You mentioned Teresa Fiore, who is the Inserra chair for Italian-American studies at Montclair State University. You're the Alfonso D'Amato chair for Italian-American studies at Stony Brook. There's the Grazia Dio chair out California State, Long Beach. These are four or five chairs, and I may have missed one, that UNICO put together. And I bring that up because it represents, at least in that sense, philanthropy, number one, towards the university, and number two, which I hope will grow more, is the dialogue that has to take place. Now, we have an international dialogue among us academics, right? But now we have to take a little bit of that conversation, quote unquote, to the streets, as Fred would say, you know, positively, you know, he would say, you know, and we use this expression in the United States, town gown, when you've got that little university on the hill, right?
It's a matter of allowing research to take place. So philanthropy is important because it makes things feasible. But it's also a matter of dialogue and of informing each other. Of course, you know, research takes all forms. Blue sky research is blue sky research, and there's always going to be a space for the most obscure of topics, for passionate engagement with those. And it's important. At the same time, it's also important that as researchers, we think of our role in society, and we've seen this more and more. And in the case of the humanities, one of the labels, indeed it was Charles Burdett who was telling me the other day, one of the labels that are now being developed is humanities as future making. You know, we have to think. I always think of Gramsci, and I think, you know, the, you can't make a better world if you can't imagine it to begin with. And so one of our roles is to make things possible by imagining them. But there's no point in imagining something in an ivory tower. We have to work with communities, and communities can inform our work. And we've been doing this, I've been doing this with groups, with civil society groups in Italy, for instance. Just the other day, I was talking to a phenomenal group called Il Razzismo Una Brutta Storia, who are active in Italy to sensitize, in particular, educators, so teachers, and then schools prepare teaching materials for teachers to address the question of racism. So, you know, if we don't engage with these groups and if we don't engage with these communities, then we're not going to make a mark.
For some of us, we have to literally change our language, change our registers, right? Because if I'm going to do a semiotic interpretation of whatever, a film, a text, whatever, I'm going to use certain terminology that, you know, you'll just say, oh, okay, whatever, you know, it's a regular word for you because you're in the academy, you deal with some of that, et cetera. But we have to think in terms of the quote unquote intelligent uninformed, right?
Even to an extent informed, but non-specialist. And yes, it's an art, you know, it doesn't apply just to us as Italian specialists or Italian American specialists. It doesn't apply even just to the humanities. But we spent a lifetime, in a sense, acquiring that specialist vocabulary, acquiring those tools. And then we have to spend another bit of time thinking about how we communicate effectively to people who don't necessarily have you know, who are absolutely knowledgeable but are not specialists in that area. And to me, again, that is an area, it's another area of translation. It may not be translation between different languages, but it's translation between different, that registers between different groups. So another thing that we did with the project that we were talking about, we privileged initially shorter, sharper, non-specialist, let's say, ways of disseminating the information and the findings of the project. And then, yes, we produced the books as well. But the books as well, we went for a research publication, but also a series of books which are for students, which are addressing the next generation. Because, again, you know, there's no future in all of this if we're not educating the next generation of scholars and the next generation of civil society.
One of the main goals of our Italian Diaspora Studies Summer Seminar, post-seminar, our main goal is that the doctoral student, or especially the professor who comes, will then go back to his or her university, and if not put up an entire course dedicated to the Italian Diaspora Studies, perhaps then part of a course that in which Italian Diaspora Studies can readily fit, but didn't before, can now be there.
Earlier today, I was talking to a colleague from Namibia, because we got to do a presentation for a conference on heritage. And so we're talking, you know, what you're talking about is also linked to notions of tangible and intangible heritage, for instance. And a lot of the heritage which we're talking about and which keeps alive that sense of communities is intangible heritage. So we need to have ways to think about that. And education is key in that. So yeah, it may not be brick and mortar, but it is at the same time something that leaves a legacy. When we work with intangible heritage, we're working with development all the time. We're developing new knowledge, we're developing new minds, we're developing new generations. So in that sense, we're not crystallizing, but at the same time fixing something in a certain way, which is right or wrong. We are allowing the debate, the discussion about how we feel, how we identify, what memories we bring with us, but also what future we imagine, as I was saying, we're allowing that dialogue to continue. So in that sense, it may be intangible, but it is, if anything, even more essential than putting your name over the door of an auditorium or something like that. And I think that's something we need to continue to say.
And to get back to your position as the Alfonso Amato Chair in Italian American Studies, Stony Brook, speaking of legacies, the late Mario Mignone left a good legacy in the Center for Italian Studies, right?
Exactly.
As well as the journal Forum Italicum. And I've said for decades that Mario really just saving and developing Forum Italicum into what it is today was, in a sense, a professional achievement you know, second to none. I mean, he saved a journal. He got it to a point where the top echelon of Sage publications and things of that sort. So you have this center. You have a couple of really good colleagues there. You're not there yet. You can't get there yet. But hopefully in the next, I don't know, 3 to 6 months, we're going to be able to at least walk into our buildings. But
we're going back in a sense to where we started, you know, to me arriving here. And as I am here now, it feels like a huge relief and a huge step that I've managed to cross the Atlantic to be on this side. Sure, it is still frustrating because, you know, just as I can't be at the Calandra, we can't be in the Calandra this morning. So I also cannot, you know, I'm already having a dialogue talking to colleagues and donors and, you know, who are active with Stony Brook and with the center. At the same time, it would have been different if we'd been able to, you know, to have public events, to meet in person. We'll have to be patient, but that doesn't mean that we can't do things. And so it is possible. There are certain paradoxical ways in which distance has been reduced. You know, some distances have been made much greater. As you were saying, I'm only 60 miles away, but we still can't get together. But other distances are reduced, so we can get together people in a sense more readily than we could, because we're all accepting that sometimes it has to be online rather than in person. One of the things that I will say is that I have been very, very positively impressed and very happy with the way in which Stony Brook itself knows and sees how important that center is and does consider it as one of its jewels. And so there is that sense of commitment to the center. And we will do everything that we can to make sure that the inheritance that comes from Professor Mignone is not squandered. And with Forum Italicum, I'm working with Giuseppe Gazzola, my colleague there, who is the current editor in chief. And he very kindly, very early on when my appointment was announced, asked me to work on a special issue which will come out next year, and we're already working on it and we'll send out news soon about it, but which will look precisely at these kinds of issues. How do we think about the production, the circulation, the reception of Italian cultures in a way that is not just that silos between national or hyphenated, but in this way that we've been working on together. And I think also, you know, the other thing to say is that we absolutely must find even more ways of working together, because here in New York and then the tri-state, we have a phenomenal pool of talent, of experience, of knowledge, and of good will from communities.
I want to thank you for taking time to be with us.
Thank you again for the invitation.
Our pleasure.
Thanks for watching this episode of Italics. I'm Anthony Tamburri. Arrivederci alla prossima puntata.